Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Amanda Hunt, the Director of Education and Public Programs here at MOCA. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. Today, we are thrilled to introduce Harryette Mullen for a reading on the occasion of Kerry James Marshall's Mastry. If you have not gone yet, you must after the reading. Harryette Mullen teaches African American literature, American poetry, and creative writing at UCLA. Her poems, short stories, and essays have been published widely. She is a recipient of a Jackson Poetry Prize, a United States Artist Fellowship, the Guggenheim Fellowship, and a Gertrude Stein Award for Innovative Poetry. Mullen's poems have been translated into many languages, and she has published 7 poetry books to date, including Recyclopedia and Sleeping with the Dictionary, a finalist for a National Book Award, a National Book Critics Circle Award, and a Los Angeles Times Book Prize. A collection of her essays and interviews, The Cracks Between What We Are and What We Are Supposed to Be, was published in 2012 by University of Alabama Press. Her most recent collection of poetry, from which she will read today among other books, Urban Tumbleweed, Notes from a Tonka Diary, was published by Gray Wolf Press in 2013. About that work, Mullen herself explained, quote, "I wanted to incorporate into my life a daily practice of walking and writing poetry, merging my wish to write poetry every day with the willingness to step outdoors. My hope was that each exercise would support the other." Please join me in welcoming her.
Thanks, everyone, for showing up for poetry. I really do appreciate it. I thought I would read a few poems that, while they're not new, they're not collected into a volume. They've been published in an anthology that's called Rainbow Darkness that came out a few years ago, but I thought I'd just begin with some of those. Well, even before that, I'd like to begin with kind of an epigraph. These are some lines from a poem by Michael Harper, who passed on a few years ago. And it's a poem, it's a passage from his poem, Dear John, Dear Coltrane. "Why you so black? 'Cause I am. Why you so funky? 'Cause I am. Why you so black? 'Cause I am. Why you so funky? 'Cause I am." Okay, so with that invocation, I'll read a few poems that I don't read too often, just because I forget that I wrote them. But they were published in Rainbow Darkness. This is Unacknowledged Legislator. After singing the final page, the poet passes out ceremonial pens. As the poem is sighed into law, rules to be made are broken, and broken rules amended. When the archival papers are all singed in blood, the poet's meter expires. This is obviously a Los Angeles poem. It's called Bumper to Bumper. And I imagine it as the conversation of the cars stuck in traffic and their bumper sticker. So it was inspired by a bumper sticker that I saw one time, and then it kind of riffs on that. "I'd rather be at the beach. I'd rather beat each ache. I'd rather be a dirty blonde than a clean-cut brunette. If I had to choose between being richer or smarter, I'd rather have the money because I'm smart enough already. I'd rather not think about it. I'd rather not go into that. I voted, but I'd rather not say which one I punched. I'd rather switch than fight. I trust my psychic friend over Dan rather. I'm stuck in traffic when I'd rather be surfing. My other car is the metro. Mi otro carro es el metro. I'd rather drive than walk. I'd rather work than starve. I'd rather drink unfiltered tap water and sleep on a lumpy futon than live anywhere else in this godforsaken world. So this one is another LA poem. I actually mostly do take the bus to work, even though I do know how to drive. And this is called Number Six Sepulveda. Arrival at terminal laxative, in and out with fries, Fox Malls Hill, a colored crowd, sad cactus left over from family's nursery going out of business sale. The drive-in movie was a used car lot, then a flea market, now it's condos. Botanica across from coffee shop near Cuban restaurant where workers gather for lunch. A few blocks down, you can get five different mole salsas and wire dollars to Oaxaca. At Pancake Palace, I hop on the bus from All Night News Guy. Today's special veggie burger at Hot Diggity, home of the Y2K dog. Turn right past Blank Soldier and Bland Sailor, a white cross for each life loss, pencils, toothpicks, chopsticks, trees in this wood, all cut down to size, pay a large sum for a large bag of popcorn. End of the line, everyone out, grab a daily Bruin and run. It's okay, the crazy people on the bus aren't talking to themselves, they're speaking on their cell phones. This poem is what I would call an inverse translation of a sonnet by Pablo Neruda, and the title of my poem, which is piggybacking on his poem, mine is called Broken Glish. Okay. Finding myself in the desert, I planted a luminous seed. I let go a howl past moist teeth, certain it couldn't have been the mute sunshine laughing, a sane cello, or a brand new brain. No one came near, nor was I ever shallow or newsworthy to you, as the moon has revealed. Only a murmur blasted by brief springs, by the dry, impenetrable glare of a taproot. I fell asleep on rational sand dunes where the cactus rasped above my toenails, a solid stench descending from oblivion. Slowly, unlike the spines I was stuck with, I spoke calmly, addressing the watery ocean I discovered in my dotage, and I went on undeterred, healed by that unwavering stink. And this poem is one that I wrote about a visit to Havana, Cuba, with a group of writers and scholars. This was some years ago. This was before the death of Fidel Castro. And we walked all over Havana. We were tourists, drinking mojitos in Cuba Libre. My mojito in la bodeguita, my daiquiri in El Floridita. A postcard of fidelity, shaking hands with earnest money. Lost in the streets of Havana, gasping for breath como un pez sin agua. As hot as it is, as black as can be, as dark as this combustible star. Sí, hace calor, pero only turistas wear big brims or ultraviolet lenses. You hot? You thirsty? You buy us mojitos? You bring your Yankee dolor? We show our splendid squalor? Milk for baby? You give me dollar? You black, we black. See my scar from the war in Angola? Still working for a Cuba Libre? Tropicolas sweeter than Coke. Mix rum and sugar with sweat of a slave. We work for pesos and beg for your stinking dollar? I'll show you where Hemingway wrote, the bar where he sipped his swizzle. You'll owe me a mojito. Que se vayan los gusanos. Crush with a pestle. Add rumba. Stir briskly with a drop of African blood. And this, I'll read the other Cuba poem. These are the two Cuba poems that actually got published that I wrote from that visit. This one's called El Malecón, which of course is the walk along the seawall at the edge of the island. So people go there for the view of the ocean and just to have a little stroll around the island. This is El Malecón. How many engineers trained to hold back a million gallons of ocean in El Malecón? How many cars speeding in El Malecón? How many couples kissing in El Malecón? How many poor folk fishing for a living in El Malecón? How many poot butt buses in El Malecón? How many hustlers hustling in El Malecón? How many male, female, and she-male cons in El Malecón? How many tourist taxis in El Malecón? How many mafia nostalgia hotels in El Malecón? How many sexy schoolgirls in El Malecón? How many mermaids on shore leave in El Malecón? How many collisions and breakdowns in El Malecón? How many starving dogs with ribs like xylophones in El Malecón? How many khaki cops with clean guns in El Malecón? Vista del Mar in El Malecón, where the guard warns us to move along because we're black, because he thinks we're prostitutes or spies, because we might throw a bomb, just because we don't belong, or he's afraid we'll clone a cyclone, aquí en El Malecón. So those were some poems I had almost forgotten about. And I'm gonna read probably the rest from Sleeping with the Dictionary. This is a poem I wrote for my nephew when he was quite young. And you know, when it was time to make my book, I thought, let me just throw this one in here. So I did. It's called Ask Aiden. This is my older nephew. Are aardvarks anxious? Do dragons dream? Ever see an eager elephant? Newts are never nervous, are they? So that was a little picture book that I made for him with alphabet stamps, and each alphabet is the shape of an animal. So the stamps suggested the imagery for the poem. This one is called Black Nikes. I'm trying to harp on a theme of blackness because of the work upstairs. These were not, some of these people were black, but most of them were not black. But they were all wearing the same shoes, black Nikes. Maybe somebody remembers that. But it used to be you could actually Google black Nikes and this story would come up. We need quarters like King Tut needed a boat. A slave could row him to heaven from his crypt in Egypt full of loot. We've lived quietly among the stars, knowing money isn't what matters. We only bring enough to tip the shuttle driver when we hitch a ride aboard a trailblazer of light. This comet could scour the planet or make it sparkle like a fresh toilet swirling with blue, or only come close enough to brush a few lost souls. Time is rotting as our bodies wait. For now I lay me down to earth, noiseless, patient spiders paid with dirt, when what we want is stardust. If nature abhors an expensive appliance, why does the planet suck ozone? This is a big ticket item a thickety ride. Please page our home and visit our sigh on the wide world's ebb. Just point and cluck at our new persuasion shoes. We're opening the gate that opens our containers for recycling. Time to throw down and take off on our launch. This flight will nail our proof of pudding. The thrill of victory is we're exiting Earth. We're leaving all this dirt. And I'm going to read Bleeding Hearts, which was inspired by the name of one of the communities in Los Angeles that we know that it's a very diverse, multicultural community, but it's not always necessarily perceived that way in media. So this poem was partly about media representation. It's called Bleeding Hearts. Crenshaw is a juicy melon. Don't spit, and when you're finished, wash your neck. Tonight, we lead with bleeding hearts, sliced raw or scooped with a spoon. I'll show my shank. I'd rend your cares with my shears. If I can't scare cash from the ashen crew, this monkey wrench has scratch to back my business. This ramshackle stack of shotguns I'm holding in my scope. I'm beady-eyed as a bug, slippery as a sardine, salty as a kipper. You could rehash me for breakfast, find my shrinking awe, or share your wink. I'll get a rash, wench. We'll crash a shower of cranes. I'm making birdseed to stick in a hen's craw. Where I live's a wren shack. Pull back. Show wreck, black fade. And let's see, this one is very much a Los Angeles poem. I think it registers my sense that Los Angeles is difficult to grasp as a concept. As a place where I have been living for some time now, but I still don't understand it. But anyway, this is Coles to Newcastle, Panama hats from Ecuador. Watching television in Los Angeles, this scene performed in real time, in real life, a pretty picture walking and sitting still. It's still life with fried spam, light pound cake, non-dairy cream. It's death by chocolate. It's corporate warfare as we know it. I'm stuck on the fourth step. There's no statue or stature of limitations. I'll be emotionally disturbed for as long as it takes. You can give a man a rock, or you can teach him to rock. Access your higher power. Facts back the map of your spiritual path. Take 20 drops, tincture of worry wart. Who's paying for this if you're not covered? You're too simple to be so difficult. Malicious postmodernism, petroleum jelly donut dunked in elbow grease. You look better going than coming. You look like death eating microwave popcorn. Now that I live alone, I'm much less introspective. Now you sound more like yourself. Okay. Okay. We having church now. Yeah, the taxi driver asked me, was I going to church? I guess because I'm wearing a dress, he asked me. And I'm a black lady, so I must be going to church. I should have said, yeah. Amen, brother. Okay, so, and the sermon for today is denigration, denigration. Now, you know, somebody got fired for saying a word that sounded like another word. But those two words don't really have anything in common. They tell us those words are not related. They sound a little too much similar. So this is denigration. Did we surprise our teachers who had niggling doubts about the picayune brains of small black children who reminded them of clean pickaninnies on a box of laundry soap? How muddy is the Mississippi compared to the third longest river of the darkest continent? In the land of the Igbo, the Hausa, and the Yoruba, what is the price per barrel of nigrescence? Those slaves who were wealth survived on niggardly provisions. Should inheritors of wealth fault the poor enigma for lacking a dictionary? Does the mayor demand a recount of every bullet, or does City Hall simply neglect the black alderman's district? If I disagree with your beliefs, do you chalk it up to my negligible powers of discrimination, supposing I'm just trifling and not worth considering? Does my niggling concern with trivial matters negate my ability to negotiate in good faith? Though maroons who were unruly Africans, not loose horses or lazy sailors, were called renegades in Spanish, will I turn any blacker if I renege on this deal? So let's see here. How about ectopia? Ectopia, which is in the wrong place. It's not the utopia, which is either the good place or the non-existent place, but it's the wrong place. Ectopia. A stout bomb wrapped with a bow, with wear you tear. It's true, you sour or rust. Some of us were sure you're in a rut. We bore your somber rub and storm. You were true, but you rust. On our tour out, we tore, we two. You were to trust in us and we in you. Terribly, you tear. You tear us. You tell us you're true. Are you sure? Most of you bow to the mob, strut with worms, strew your woe. So store your tears, tout your worst, be a brute if you must. You tear us most terribly. To the tomb we rue our rust and rot. You tear, you wear us out. You try your best, but we're bust. You tear out of us. We tear from stem to stem. You trouble, you butter me most. You tear, but you tell us. Trust us to suture you. So, let's see. I want to read a tribute to another poet who has passed on. That was Jane Cortez. And, you know, she has some connection to Los Angeles, just like Kerry James Marshall. Lived in Los Angeles, and Jane Cortez lived in Los Angeles during the part of the period of the Black Arts Movement. She's associated with the Watts writers, and she was a lover of jazz music. So this poem is a collaboration between me and the ethnocentric software of my spell checker. Because, you know, her name is spelled J-A-Y-N-E-C-O-R-T-E-Z. So every time I would try to write Jane, of course, it would make her not a fancy Jane, but a plain Jane. And it would turn Cortez into Cortex. So that's how I got this poem called Fancy Cortex. I'm using my plain brain to imagine her fancy cortex. As if my lowly mollusk could wear so exalted a mantle as her pontifex pallium. As if the knots and tangles of my twisted psyche could mesh with her intricate synaptic network of condensed neural convolutions. as if my simple chalk could fossilize the memory of her monumental reefs of cauliflural coral, as if my shallow, unschooled shoals could reckon the calculus of her conch's brainwaved tsunami, as if the pedestrian software of my mundane explorer could map as rounded colonies the terra incognita of her undiscovered hemispheres, as if the speculative diagnosis of my imaging technology could chart the direction of her intuitive intellect, as if the inquisitive iris of my galaxy orbiting telescope could see as far as her vision, as if the trained nostrils of my narco bloodhound could sniff out what she senses in the wind, as if my duty-free bottle of jerk sauce could simulate the fire ant picante that inflames her tongue of rage, as if the gray matter of my dim bulb could be enlightened by the brilliance of her burning watts, as if her divergent universification might fancy the microcosm of my prosaic mind. So, let's see, I wanted to read one that was inspired by the Watts Towers, you know, which has inspired many Los Angeles artists. And so this poem is called Suzuki Method, and the backstory of the poem, you know, goes somewhere else, of course, but the backstory was that I was showing a visitor from Japan around the city, and one of the stops that we made was the Watts Towers. And my Japanese is below zero, and his English was not too much better. And so it's partly an East meets West poem and a poem about not quite communicating with someone, but you know, we were both trying our best. And also that at the time, you know, there are different explanations for what Rodia thought he was doing. And one of them suggests that the towers of the of his, you know, his creative project, lifetime project, that those are representations of parade floats honoring Marco Polo, that those are the mass of the ships of Marco Polo. That's one of the stories. I know there are other stories about Watts Towers. Anyway, so this is Suzuki Method. El Nino brought a typhoon of tom-toms from Tokyo, where a thrilling instrument makes an okay toy. Tiny violins are shrill. Their shrieks are musical mice. The color of a mechanical clock is lost in translation. Whatever you're telling me sounds like the straight teeth of rodents. My dreams throw the book at the varmint. We both shudder as the dictionary thuds. You've got to admit our Esperanto's hopeless. Your virgin is unfaithful. My savory hero boards the ship of Marco Polo, loaded with soy from Ohio. So, give you a little trip around this book. I think I will go ahead and read the poem. I do read often. That is my collaboration with a famous poet who left this earth a long time ago, but left us a lot of riches, literary riches. And I am proud to be his collaborator. And this poem's called Dim Lady. My honey bunches peepers are nothing like neon. Today's special at Red Lobster is redder than her kisser. If liquid paper is white, her racks are institutional beige. If her mop were slinkies, dishwater slinkies would grow on her noggin. I have seen tablecloths in Shakey's pizza parlors red and white, but no such picnic colors do I see in her mug. And in some minty fresh mouthwashes, there is more sweetness than in the garlic breeze my main squeeze wheezes. I love to hear her rap, yet I'm aware that Muzak has a hipper beat. I don't know any Marilyn Monroes. My ball and chain is plain from head to toe, and yet, by gosh, my scrumptious Twinkie has as much sex appeal for me as any lanky model or platinum movie idol who's hyped beyond belief. Yes, those dead white men are sometimes fun to collaborate with. Okay, this poem is called Zombie Hat. I don't read this one too often, but I'll read it today. Greatest thing since Texas toast, the ever popular zombie hat flies off the shelf like sandwich loaf for your tete-a-tete with a headhunter or chat with a shrink. Zombie hat's the right think. You'll look like a hero in your zombie sombrero. Don't forget to wear your hat. It's what the head cheese ordered, stat. Statistics show the zombie hat helps to maintain social stasis. With the right fit, you'll brim with social graces. We recommend it for all our head cases. Meet every problem head on, so long as you keep a lid on. Now, this is definitely a Los Angeles poem. It's called Wino Rhino. And, you know, I'm not the first person to imagine a human being turning into a rhinoceros. That's been done before. For no specific reason, I have become one of the city's unicorns. No rare species, but one in range of danger. No mythical animal, but a common creature of urban legend. No potent stallion woven into poetry and song, just the tough, horny beast you may observe roaming at large in our habitat. I'm known to adventurers whose drive-by safari is this circumscribed wilderness. Denatured photographers like to shoot me, tipping the bottle, capture me, snorting dust, mount on the wall my horn of empties that spilled the grape's blood. My flesh crawls with itchy insects. My heart quivers as arrows on street maps target me for urban removal. You can see that my hair's stiffened and my skin's thick, but the bravest camera can't document what my armor hides, how I know you so well, why I know my own strength, why when I charge you with my rags, I won't overturn your sporty Jeep. So I think I will read one more. We are open to the possibility of comments and questions from the audience. So if you want to ask a question or make a comment, you can be thinking about that while I'm going to read the last one, which is wipe that simile off your aphasia. And, you know, I have a very fond memory that this poem actually was made into a poster for the metro system. And since I actually do ride the bus, so I would ride the bus, you know, one whole month my poem was on the bus, and I get on the bus and sit right under my poem. Yes, poetry in motion. And you know, what happened to poetry in motion? We don't see that anymore because, you know, the money has to go elsewhere, I'm sure, not to poetry. Wipe that simile off your aphasia. As horses as four, as purple as we go, as heartbeat as if, as silverware as it were, as onion as I can, as cherries as feared, as combustion as want, as dog color as expected, as oboes as anyone, as umbrella as catch can, as penmanship as it gets, as narcosis as could be, as hit parade as all that, as icebox as far as I know, as fax machine as one can imagine, as cyclones as hoped, as dictionary as you like, as shadow as promised, as drinking fountain as well, as grass fire, as myself, as never, as mirror, as is, as never, as this. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for being here. And I if you have thoughts, questions, comments, feel free. Now is the time to express them. Yes.
I'm a newcomer to LA, and I was curious about what you said about how you don't understand Los Angeles.
I still don't.
Yeah, and I wondered if you could say more about that, and if you feel like it, maybe read that poem again.
Oh. Well, I could just say that it's a complicated place, as you may have noticed. And in fact, you know, I think sometimes that I'm starting to know my way around, and then I will get hopelessly lost. And then even the things that I thought were landmarks, you know, they may no longer be there. Well, first I was really kind of amazed that people would say as a landmark, they'd say the overpass of a freeway as a landmark, you know, or a Starbucks as a landmark. So those kinds of things were kind of driving me crazy. But this is a complicated place, and it's good. It's wonderfully complicated, and sometimes it's tragically complicated. And I'll just say that. Let's see if there are other questions. If you want to hold on, I might read the poem again. But if there are other comments or questions, I'd like to hear them. Yes. I saw a hand. No? Yeah.
I don't need the mic. I was wondering if you could share a little bit of your process, because there was one poem where you were really playing with this sound,
yes,
play with the means, the words, and kind of like replace words with other words.
Yes.
And that's when you turn to process with starting a poem.
Mm-hmm.
How, like, you could share like how an idea comes from the seed.
Okay. Well, I can talk about maybe one of the poems you were referring to, which is Bleeding Hearts, the poem, Crenshaw poem, because basically it's not a documentary about Crenshaw, obviously. It starts with something very obvious, which is that Crenshaw also happens to be the name of a melon. You know, there's a Crenshaw melon. So the idea of Crenshaw as a juicy melon, and I wanted to squeeze the melon. So I squeezed the word Crenshaw, and the sounds, the SH sounds and the AW sounds and the KR sounds, those are distributed, you know, throughout the poem. So the poem is playing with the sounds of the word Crenshaw. There's another poem that does that, which is Ectopia also. And the sounds in that poem that I was playing with is from the word uterus. 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 So, yeah, sometimes a poem comes from breaking a word down, not necessarily etymologically, but in terms of its phonic, you know, it's the pieces of the word sound to the ears, and those sounds in other words. The poems that have to do with substitution are based on a technique from what was a historical avant-garde group called Ulipo, which was an international group. It includes Ulipo, which is from the words in French, ouvrage de littérature potentielle, which is the workshop of potential literature. And their most famous, at least the one I know, American member just died recently. Harry Matthews was a member of this group. Most of them are Europeans, but Harry Matthews is an American writer who was a member of this group, mostly a fiction writer. And so what their idea was that you don't have to be struck by some kind of divine inspiration to write. You can create rules, and that language is a game that you can play to create potential literature, that not every game of language will result in a literary work, but potentially it could result in a literary work. And it takes some of the burden off of the creator as this sort of divinely inspired person by saying, this is a game that you can play, you can create the rules, and also you can break the rules, which I always do. So one of their games is called N plus 7 or S plus 7. The Europeans usually say S plus for substantive, and Americans used to say N plus for noun, plus 7. And so a substantive is just any word that's used as a noun in a sentence. So if you have a pre-existing text and you have a dictionary, you could, one of the formulas, I mean, it could be S plus 4, or it could be S minus 3, you know, but it's a formula for substituting the words in a text with other words that come out of the dictionary. So with a dictionary, you can create a new text that has echoes of the previous text. So that's how Dim Lady was written, from Shakespeare's Sonnet 130. There are actually two poems in this book that are based on the same Shakespeare sonnet. The Dark Lady, one of the Dark Lady sonnets, "My mistress' eyes are nothing like the sun." I use some of these things in my creative writing classes to suggest to students that it is possible to create without having, you know, some idea of totally original, totally inspired work, that you can start with a text that exists and alter it according to particular rules or procedures. So, is that?
Wow, so you have maybe different sets of rules for each poem that you create?
Well, rules, I use it very loosely. I mean, I think the Ulipo people were a little bit more serious. They wrote manifestos, artist manifestos, about how one should apply these rules. And they have different kinds of rules. Often they're based on mathematical formulas of addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and maybe even more complicated mathematical principles. And some of them were computer programmers, and some of them were linguists and mathematicians. So they were interested in a relationship between numbers and words, and between arithmetic and math and literature. That's not especially, you know, what I'm interested in as a poet, but I was interested in the idea of other ways of writing besides waiting to be somehow tapped on the shoulder by the divine muse, and writing poems that have a degree of non-intention. You know, I was interested in the idea of the poem being opened up to things that I did not consciously intend to write. And so some of those poems start to sound a little bit like a schizophrenic word salad, you know, or like Lewis Carroll's Jabberwocky, you know, where you have a text that, even though probably 90% of that text is nonsense, it's words that he made up that don't exist anywhere else but in that poem. And but we recognize, we're able to understand the poem at a certain level because the syntax of the sentences, the order of the sentences, the story that the sentences tell is familiar to us. So there's some convention that is just built into the way language operates. So you could even take out of the sentences, you know, you could put in words that really don't exist, that are nonsense, and it still makes a sort of sense to us because we hear the echo of the structure, the linguistic structure, and the story structure.
Thank you.
Ah, okay. Yes, back there.
Well, it's just a small, curious point, and that is, so when you produce a poem and you have a reference,
mm-hmm.
a clear reference in your mind,
yes.
you say,
Right.
Mm-hmm. Is it like a rule that you somewhere under the publication or whatever make reference points to mm-hmm. Shakespeare's do you have to do that? Is it possible you're not?
Well, I think probably different writers and different people, readers also would have different ideas about that. I didn't do that in this book because I am assuming, maybe I shouldn't assume, that people do know this sonnet because it's one of the most famous sonnets of Shakespeare. And also it appears twice in the book. Two versions of the same sonnet appear in the book. So that's a way of telling the reader, oh, by the way, this poem and that other poem come from the same source. But I use the rule different ways to make each poem. And so these poems are different, but you can hear the similarity between them. So that's a sly way of telling the reader that there was a source, a common source for these two poems. And then readers that are literary, you know, in their background, probably would recognize that. When I do read it in public, I normally will say something about the bard or the dead white male that I've collaborated with. I mean, I'm actually collaborating with him and with Webster or whoever's dictionary I'm using. So it's me and the dictionary and Shakespeare collaborating to make that poem. Sure, keep going.
Mm-hmm. Have them available here for purchase?
No, I'm sorry that I don't, but this book, Sleeping with the Dictionary, is available from University of California Press, and if you Googled my name, books will come up. Oh, by the way, speaking of Googling, I participated recently in a project that I want to tell you all about. It's called Renga for Obama, Renga, R-E-N-G-A. And so Renga is a collaborative poem. It's written by a bunch of poets. And in this case, it's 200 plus poets writing these little verses for Obama. So I wrote a haiku, which is followed by a waki that another poet wrote. And then our verse is linked to the one before it and the one after it. So it's online right now. It's on the website for the Harvard Review. And I believe when all of the poets have contributed, their plan is to make a book called Renga for Obama. But it's on the website now. And so every week they add new links to this poem. It's an unfolding collaborative project. Mm-hmm. Yes. Here comes the microphone.
Anyway, I just wanted to say, you said comments or questions. The comment is that I really, really enjoy your poetry. It's so wonderful to
Thank
listen
you.
To. And your delivery is beautiful, too, when you get the flow on and everything. But your use of syllables, your syllabic dexterity, you know, the way that you just, the syllables just pile up, and not just rhymes, but alliteration and whatever the word is for alliteration at the end of the sentences.
Yes.
It's just so beautiful. And then also, your metaphors are off the wall, like parkour off the wall. Like your metaphors are like I almost don't get some of them, and then I kind of almost do, and that's one of the best kind of metaphors. So,
okay.
Seriously. One question I had was, do you speak or understand any other languages besides English?
Well, okay, I studied French, I studied Spanish, and I even studied Latin, but I don't really retain them very well. You know, I was studying Castilian Spanish when the people that I might have practiced to speak with were not speaking that variety of Spanish. And I should have traveled when I was much younger or done some immersion, or I'm not sure. The way that they were teaching languages back in the day was not always the best way. So at one time I was a pretty good reader of Spanish and somewhat mediocre reader of French, and Latin helped me with my SAT, I'm sure. But, and you know, I think knowing that words come from other words, and that I think of words as being members of big families, you know.
Are Are you a linguist by any background?
I'm not a linguist. I did take some linguistics courses when I was in college, and a lot of literature courses and, you know, writing courses. So, you know, I studied, tried to study, even though my focus is on American poetry and particularly African American literature. I also read, you know, European literature, African literature, Caribbean literature, South American literature, Mexican literature. You know, I've written an article on Wisława Szymborska, who was, won the Nobel Prize for poetry. She was Polish. I mean, I had to read her work in translation because I definitely don't read or speak Polish. But I, you know, I admired her as a poet. So.
Last thing I'll ask, and I'll put give this thing away, is you mentioned travel, and I was wondering about that. Do you travel a lot now? Is that part of your life these days?
I try to travel when I'm able to, and particularly if people invite me to come somewhere. So I have been to Mexico, Canada, Cuba, Costa Rica, Spain, Brazil, Germany, France, England, did I say Sweden? Anyway, those are some places that I've been to, and usually it was because of poetry. Poetry allowed me to go to those places and meet amazing people. Yeah, thank you. So are we done with questions and comments? I'm happy to, oh, and did you want to hear that poem again? Was it Bleeding Hearts that you wanted to? No, it was Coles to Newcastle. So I will read Coles to Newcastle again. Watching television in Los Angeles, this scene performed in real time, in real life, a pretty picture walking and sitting still. It's still life with fried Spam, light pound cake, non-dairy cream. It's death by chocolate. It's corporate warfare as we know it. I'm stuck on the fourth step. There is no statue or stature of limitations. I'll be emotionally disturbed for as long as it takes. You can give a man a rock or you can teach him to rock. Access your higher power. Facts back the map of your spiritual path. Take 20 drops tincture of worry wart. Who's paying for this if you're not covered? You're too simple to be so difficult. Malicious postmodernism, petroleum jelly donut dunked in elbow grease. You look better going than coming. You look like death eating microwave popcorn. Now that I live alone, I'm much less introspective. Now you sound more like yourself. Thank you all for being here. One more question.
Yes? Okay. Thank you. Dear, I'm so happy to have caught the tail end of your work. My name is Kim Nickerson. I'm a graduate of UCLA.
All right.
And I just want to know. Yes, the Bruins. I just want to know, darling, did you have any black historical poets that you admire?
Langston Hughes, Margaret Walker, Paul Laurence Dunbar. Amiri Baraka, Jane Cortez. I read a poem about Jane Cortez, or devoted to Jane Cortez.
What about Nikki Giovanni?
Not my favorite, but I have gone to hear her read in public. Is she your favorite?
Yes.
Okay, some of her poems I really do love. I love, I Was Born in the Congo.
Yes.
I love that
yes.
one.
Yes. And you are a professor.
Yes, I teach English.
That is so, so lovely. Thank you so very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us.